And good morning, colleagues and members of the public who are here. Welcome to the 16th meeting in 2016 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. I also welcome Linda Fabiani to the committee this morning, who's here as an observer status, but as obviously entitled to ask questions when she gets the opportunity. Usual reminder about mobile phones, please. And let's get straight to the first item on our agenda, which is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members are agreed. Thank you. The second item on our agenda is to take evidence from HMRC as part of our scrutiny on the forthcoming budget, which we know will be draft budget will be published this Thursday. The session will also form part of our ongoing scrutiny of the implementation of the Scotland Act 2016. I know that members have received written copies of material from HMRC, also copies of the Memorandum of Understanding, and a paper from SPICE, providing some additional information for us. We're joined for this session this morning with Jim Hara, who's the Director General for Customer Strategy and Tax Design, and Sarah Walker, who's the Deputy Director for Devolution in HMRC. I welcome you both to our session this morning. Jim Hara, do you want to make an opening statement?
I'll just make some brief comments.
Yeah, please, thank you. Please feel free.
Thank you, Convener. So, this is my first appearance before the committee as HMRC's accounting officer for Scottish Income Tax. I took over the role earlier this year, but it means I'm accountable for implementation and operation of the Scottish rate of income tax and also the additional income tax powers given to the Scottish Government and Parliament under the Scotland Act 2016. And obviously I welcome the opportunity to update you on our progress with implementing all of that and hopefully reassure you that where we're spending Scottish Government money, that we're doing that wisely and efficiently and effectively. The Department recognises the importance of the Scottish rate of income tax and the further powers to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament. And we take their effective delivery and ongoing administration very seriously. But we are treading new territory here. It is a long time since there have been variations in income tax rates or thresholds within the nations of the UK, and also it is new for us to be identifying Scottish taxpayers, and there is no benchmark against that from for which we can assess ourselves. But we have been working very closely and effectively with the Scottish Government. And last month I met my counterpart Alison Stafford to give her an opportunity to hear and about our progress and obviously to challenge us and question us on what we're doing on behalf of the Scottish Government, and obviously I hope Sarah and I can equally do the same for you today. Just to say where we are on implementing in particular the IT to administer the income tax. So we have already implemented everything we need to for the Scottish rate of income tax and also for pay as you earn on the new income tax, but there are still some things that we have to do, in particular self-assessment for the new powers that comes in later, because obviously people won't be making their self-assessment returns till sometime down the line. So we've got IT changes still to make for that. We've also still got some IT changes to make so that we can account for Scottish income tax through all accounting systems. And finally, we're still working on what is quite a significant challenge in relation to relief at source for pension schemes and making sure that Scottish taxpayers get the right rate of relief when they contribute to those schemes. That's all I want to say.
Okay, Jim, you say it's been a long time since you've been involved in this type of project. Probably it's longer than that, because the first time in Scottish history we've ever set an income tax here in Scotland. So.
I'm not an expert, so I don't know whether centuries ago there was. Certainly,
I don't think there was an income tax before 300 years ago.
Possibly not.
As I'm aware, I think there's property issues. But so this is historic stuff you're involved in. But as far as the challenges that remain go around self-assessment and these other areas you outlined around pensions, etc., can you just give us a bit more in-depth description of what these challenges are and what you're doing to make the organisation fit to face these?
Yes, Sarah is closer to the detail, so I'll let Sarah step in a moment. But we have got three projects. So we've got a project for the Scottish rate of income tax, we've got a project for the additional income tax powers, and then we've got a project for the relief at source scheme to make sure that those pension schemes can get the right relief to their customers. Those are all on track to deliver in good time, and we have some interim arrangements in the meantime for the relief at source schemes, which we believe will work until we can get a more efficient scheme in place. And we do estimate actually that the costs of implementing all of that IT will be lower than we previously thought. So, you know, that is positive. I don't know whether you want to add anything.
No, I think that's the main. Those are the main highlights. For self-assessment, what we need to do is to make sure that when somebody gets their tax return, we can get them to tick a box or to indicate in a positive way whether they lived in Scotland during the year in question and therefore are liable to tax at Scottish rates. For the pension schemes, the issue will only arise if the basic rate is different in between Scotland and the rest of the UK, because relief is given automatically at source at the basic rate for pension contributions, where you pay into a personal pension or a pension that's not run by your employer. And in those cases, we are setting up a digital system to exchange information with the pension administrators to allow them to identify who on their books of their contributors is a Scottish taxpayer and therefore claim relief from us at the appropriate rate.
And I should just add that during the course of this year, we have introduced an entirely new digital account for all pay-as-you-earn taxpayers called the Personal Tax Account. And there are currently over 7 million users of that. And from the outset, we have included in that new digital account, people can see that they are a Scottish taxpayer and the Scottish rate of income tax is visible in that new account.
And the self-assessment, those who have self-assessed, which I think from your paper was about 14% of the taxpayers' base, what progress are you making there?
Yes, so obviously the first self-assessment returns that relate to this tax year will take some time to come in, so we have a longer period to put all the IT in place to make sure that the self-assessment system calculates the right rate of tax for the people who we've identified on our database as Scottish taxpayers, and that all flows through to our accounting systems. But we're able to do that on a slightly longer timetable than was the case for pay as you earn, and that's on track to deliver on time.
Understand that. Can you tell us today what the overall cost of the Scottish Government so far has been in the implementation of the Scotland Act and how that's broken down?
Shall I? So far, the cost has been £12 million. That's mostly consists of the IT changes that we've made so far and the communications activity that happened last year when we were setting up a list and database of Scottish taxpayers. The overall estimate is between £25 and £30 million for implementing the Scotland Act 2012 changes. So that's the basic Scottish income tax rate and the relief at source changes. That consists of roughly £10 million of non-IT expenditure, which includes communications, staff costs, data cleansing activity, and marketing. The estimate for income tax, for IT within that £20 to £25 million is between £15 and £20 million. And that's partly the IT changes that Jim's already mentioned, plus the remaining relief at source system that still has to be implemented.
Well, that's obviously in terms of the initial costs, which were originally estimated between £40 and £45 million. That's a considerable
It's come down significantly.
Reduction,
yes,
which is a good thing for Scottish taxpayers, obviously, because it's them that's paying for this at the end of the day. And going forward, are there other costs that you can see beginning to emerge that the Scottish Government might have to absorb?
There will be an ongoing business as usual cost, if you like. The amount of that will depend on whether the rates of tax are the same in Scotland as in the rest of the UK or if they're different. If they're the same as they are in the current year, the costs are going to be fairly low. There will be some cost of dealing with inquiries and complaints and communication around whether somebody has got the correct tax code. There's some costs around compliance activity, which won't have happened yet because it happens after the end of the year, but we're already planning for compliance, for checking and assurance activity to make sure that we've correctly identified Scottish taxpayers. I think the figure that we gave for the estimate was between 1.5 and 2 million a year in the year when the rates were not different. In a year where the rates are different, it will clearly depend on the nature of the difference and how many people that affects. But we do expect significantly more inquiries, more code changes, and more compliance activity, more active compliance activity in a year where there is a differential between the Scottish rate and the UK rates. And we've said that's around about 5 million in a year. But again, those are estimates. We're still working to refine the activity, particularly what we would be doing in terms of compliance. So we'll revise those figures once we know more.
It was interesting in the terms of the memorandum of understanding, if there was a dispute over costs, there was quite a clear mechanism to deal with IT issues in particular, going to an independent source to resolve any of that. It didn't seem to me be as clear, though, on the administration side of things about... It didn't mention any independent process in the administration costs if there were different views about what these were and how that would be resolved. Is there something in the service level agreement that we've yet to see that covers that?
I think it's... In the area of IT, there may be circumstances where you want to get in an external expert to say whether the solution that we propose to implement is a correct solution, and that is something you might well want an expert to look at. In terms of the non-IT costs, there are things like do you do advertising, do you write letters to people, how much compliance activity do you do, and that's not really the sort of thing that's amenable to having an external expert to come in and ask. The way it is determined is, first of all, by discussion in our project and programme boards, where the Scottish Government is represented, so that they are part of that process of deciding what to do. If there is a dispute, there is a process to escalate that, which can ultimately go to ministers to decide, though obviously we hope that would never happen.
Effectively, that would end up with the GMC if required, but unlikely to happen.
It's the JEC, I think, the JEC, the Joint Exchequer Committee.
Okay, I'm curious. Do any other jurisdictions, or indeed the Treasury, have a service level agreement with the HMRC, and where the Treasury pay for any changes that are implemented at the budget process?
The Treasury pay for everything we do, ultimately. But yes, I mean, we are one of the Chancellor's departments, and we do have an annual sort of remit letter from the Chancellor setting out what it is he expects us to achieve in the coming year and the funding that he's giving the department to do that. And then on his behalf, Treasury officials do monitor that. We don't call it an MOU or a service level agreement, it's called the remit letter, but it is in effect my permanent secretary's performance agreement for the year that the Chancellor sets him to achieve the key priorities.
Okay. And there's no other jurisdictions you work on behalf of?
We do certainly have memorandum of understanding and service level agreements with other government departments for whom we provide services or who provide services to us. So, for example, in relation to customs, activity at the border is carried out by the Border Force, but I am responsible for UK customs, so I do have a memorandum of understanding and a service level agreement with the Border Force, both for what they do for me, but also for the data and other support that I give them to enable them to do their job.
Okay, thank you.
There's also the collection of student loan repayments, which we do on behalf of whichever department it is now, I'm sorry. But we do have formal agreements for the activity that we do on behalf of another department to collect those payments.
Get that overall picture. Thank you very much. That deals with some of the cost issues. But I think we want to get into resource issues now. Marie, you wanted to begin on that?
I do. Thank you very much, Convener. HMRC are closing 18 offices in Scotland with a loss of about 2,000 jobs, which, as you can imagine, is causing a great deal of concern, including in my own constituency, Inverness. I represent the Highlands and Islands. Inverness is set to be one of the first offices to close. The majority of HMRC workers believe that the UK government plans will negatively affect the staff and their ability to collect tax and to enforce tax compliance. And added to that, your clients haven't made quite the switch to digital that you hoped for. So the number of calls to your helplines have remained the same. It's just the waiting times got longer. Mark Sirotka, General Secretary of the PCS Union, said that the HMRC collects the taxes that pay for all the public services we rely on. The very fabric of our society depends on it being properly resourced and well run. So I'd like to ask you what you can tell us today that will restore our confidence in HMRC's ability to correctly collect the tax that we need to run the country.
Okay, so thank you. In last year's budget and spending review, the department was given investment of £2.1 billion, and we are tasked with using that investment so that at the end of this spending review period, we have achieved £700 million a year cost efficiencies in the department, but that we have also brought in over the course of that time an additional £8 billion in revenues over and above what we were previously expected to bring in, and that we contribute to compliance cost reductions for businesses as well. So there is investment to go with the change that we need to make, so it's not simply cuts. In the case of customer services, you're right, a key part of our transformation programme is digital, replacing sort of more traditional forms of contact and processing within our offices, and a large proportion of that £700 million efficiency savings we would expect to come from the introduction of those digital services. We're certainly not behind in implementing them. On the contrary, the new personal tax account that I mentioned, which was introduced in January this year, we had a target that by the end of March we would have 7 million users of that account. In fact, we've already exceeded 7 million users, and the satisfaction ratings on that are very, very good. That account can currently enable a taxpayer to do about 60% of the things that they want to do themselves online, where previously they had to ring us or write to us to carry out a simple transaction. So it is both helping us in terms of making us more efficient, but fits with the way I think taxpayers want to run their lives. It is an ambitious transformation programme, and we do have to take care that as we make the changes, first of all, that we make them the way we plan to do so, and that they have the benefits that we need, so that there isn't a reduction in customer service. In terms of our call handling at the moment, for about the last 13 months, we've been handling between 85 and 90% of all the calls that we receive, and our average call waiting time is below 5 minutes, which is not where we want to be, but it is a lot better than it was, you know, a couple of years ago. And we have a plan to reduce that down to below 3 minutes. So I think it is something that we need to take care as we make our transformation, that we understand the service impacts and that we are managing that effectively. But the aim of using this investment is that at the end of this spending review period, we will have a modernised digital tax authority that is actually delivering better service and better revenues for government as well.
Okay.
Yep.
Patrick Harvey, and I think Linda Fabiani probably wants in this area as well. So, yeah.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. For transparency, Convener, can I just let the committee know that I'm a member of the PCS Parliamentary Group, which is not a group of MSPs who are members of PCS, but we're MSPs who regularly meet with PCS to discuss issues of importance to the union and its members. So I just wanted to make that clear. However, that being said, you'll be aware that PCS have expressed serious concerns about the impact of the changes that are happening, not just the scale of job losses, but the impact of, for example, sites moving from place to place and people being unable or unwilling to move with those changes of location. That itself isn't just potentially unfair to individuals. It could have a serious impact on HMRC's ability to retain skills that it needs, even just in business as usual, but not least at a time when, as we've acknowledged, you're undertaking extremely complex and historic new structures in terms of administering tax very differently in Scotland. Can you give us any sense of how you've engaged with those concerns, how you've responded to those concerns, and you know, whether we can have any confidence that these changes are compatible with this extraordinary new challenge that's being taken on?
Yes. So, first of all, just to set the challenge in context, the department is, I think, still left with a legacy of the way we did business in the past, which is a network of sometimes very small offices, about 170 of them, which...
One, actually.
Okay, which date from a time when the local tax office served the local population. That's not the way tax services in this country, or indeed most other countries, work now. And so the purpose of this transformation programme is to move to having 13 large regional centres around the country, plus a small number of specialist sites and also some transitional sites as well, because we recognise that we do have to take time to make this transition, both to make sure that we retain the skills we need as we make the change, but also to help our people with the impact. So that's the strategic challenge. You're quite right. There are clearly impacts on our people as we do that. We believe that the vast majority of our people will be able to make the transition with us, but unfortunately it is the case that some won't. We definitely want to treat everyone fairly, no matter what their circumstances. What we've done to date is, for the whole of the programme, we have modelled what we think the impact is going to be on our people. But as we get closer to implementing a change in any office, we sort of move from that modelling to having a one-to-one discussion with every individual affected to make sure we gather actual information about the impacts on people. But for example, in Scotland, our modelling indicates that more than 90% of our staff are within reasonable daily travelling of the new sites where we intend to have regional centres. The selection of where we have regional centres, there are a number of criteria that's relevant, but our key aim, obviously, is to have a centre in which we can really develop and exploit our people's skills and give them good careers, but also that we can recruit and retain really good new skills as well. And Scotland came out quite very well in that, so it's the only part of the country where we're having two regional centres. All other regions have one, and I think that reflects the calibre of the staff that we believe we can recruit and retain here, and also the quality of the infrastructure that we'll be able to use. If you look at our programme, it is phased over a period of time, and as we make the changes, we are retaining some large transitional sites for quite a long period, and that is a recognition of the fact that we must not move too fast on this, and that we must not lose skills that we need as we make the transition. So, for example, here in Scotland, the intention is to keep East Kilbride as a transitional site for about another 9 years as we make the move to Glasgow and Edinburgh.
You place a lot of emphasis on retaining skilled staff and experienced staff. Can you tell us with any confidence whether at the end of this process of change, the cumulative amount of experience in terms of person years, say, within Scotland will be the same or lower, and if lower, how much lower?
Well, I think we're going to experience change in that, even if we don't make this transformation, because our workforce, about 48% of our workforce is over 50, and therefore, we have quite a challenge in refreshing our workforce over this period anyway, even if we stayed in our existing locations. We are very active recruiters. For example, we bring in about 250 graduate entrant recruits onto tax programmes, which makes us one of the largest graduate employers. And that's in recognition of the fact that we've got to constantly refresh our workforce. So I think we do face a challenge over the next few years, regardless of what we do on estates, in making sure that we maintain our skill levels and experience, and that we pass on knowledge from people who are leaving the organisation to new people who are joining.
Just one last point on this, if there's time, convener. The whole economy is all of us are aware that there's the potential for a new wave of unemployment coming from sophisticated automation, the application of AI and so on. Is that something that you anticipate happening within HMRC in the coming years ahead? And is that something you've discussed with your workforce representatives?
Not AI that I'm aware of, but certainly technology, yes. So digital technology, which enables taxpayers to self-serve in the tax system and do things themselves, where previously they had to contact a member of staff to intermediate between them and the tax system. That is definitely happening. And I would say that is almost a parallel, if you like, with online banking, where now banks give you access to the banking system as opposed to using a cashier to intermediate between you and the system. And that, the same is happening in tax. So technology is definitely having that effect. We are certainly also harnessing sort of automated data analytics to help us with our risk assessment, where previously you would have used manual methods. So technology makes us, I think, more efficient. Whether you take those efficiencies then as cost savings, or whether you reinvest those efficiencies in seeking, you know, more revenues and closing the tax gap even more, is something that we have discussions with ministers about all the time. And actually, we have got quite a good track record of securing reinvestment of savings from ministers in each fiscal event.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Patrick. Linda Fabiani.
Very quick questions, Convener, that with straight answers. Mr. Hara, first of all, you mentioned about East Kilbride, which I represent, and you said about the lease being for another 9 years, which I presume is the one in Queensbay House. Can you tell me whether, in fact, that lease, which is with a private company, has a break clause that you would consider using before that 9 years, or if that's an absolutely firm commitment to 9 years should you decide, in fact, not to stay in East Kilbride?
It's our intention to remain. You're right, it is Queensway House in East Kilbride. We've currently got two buildings there, Plaza Tower and Queensway House. It is our intention to close Plaza Tower, but to keep Queensway House open until 25-26, and obviously staff would move into that building. That is dependent on us securing good terms from the landlord for that. So it is our intention to do it, but I can't tell you firmly that that is definitely going to happen, because it depends on negotiation with the landlord on the terms of that.
So that means there is a break clause then that you could leave earlier if you...
I mean, I'm not an expert on the lease in that building, but I assume it must be. Otherwise, I'm not sure what leverage we have to get terms from our landlord. But I know that, you know, we are actively engaged in doing that, because it is our wish to keep that building open till 25-26 as one of our longer transitional sites. But I can't firmly commit that that's going to happen, because it is dependent on negotiation.
Okay, thank you. And my other quick question, you know, as we know, these rationalisation plans for HMRC have actually been around and on the table for many, many years now. In fact, prior to not only this government, but prior to the agreements that have come through the Scotland Acts for Scotland, I just wondered what additional conversations had taken place around about devolution and the additional work and expertise that is required to set up the new Scottish rate of income tax and everything else that goes along with that. Mm-hmm. Did the plans change?
I think the answer to that is they do iterate all the time. So the plan that we have for regional centres is a pan-UK sort of structure for the department. However, the workforce plans for how many people we want in different locations and what different types of jobs and different types of skills we need in each location iterate all the time and get adjusted all the time. And there is a change control process in our location programme that enables any part of the department that needs to change its workforce plan to do that, and for estates then to evaluate how they can meet that requirement. There will be undoubtedly be changes such as legislative changes throughout this period, which will require adjustment to what it is we are doing. And I mentioned that we do have a good track record of getting reinvestment, and, you know, if we got additional resources during this period, then again we would have to iterate the plans to accommodate that.
Yeah. And from the devolution department point of view, were they fully included in further discussion?
Yeah, I think the Scottish income tax is being introduced as part of our existing PAYE system. It's not a big separate exercise, and it won't require a lot of separate people to operate it. It is just another aspect of PAYE self-assessment income tax that is the job that is being done across the whole country. I think the other point to make is that the additional costs of that of doing that are being met by the Scottish Government, so there is not an issue of us sort of squeezing the resources for the Scottish rate because of problems elsewhere, because they are kept separate.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Linda. Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Good morning. I'd like to go back to something the Convener touched on earlier, which is the question of identification of the Scottish taxpayer, which is an issue which will become increasingly important as we go forward, particularly if we get differential tax rates between Scotland and the rest of the UK. Now, you say in your submission that there was an issue with the issue of notification letters. How confident are you now about the accuracy of your data on the identification of Scottish taxpayers?
I mean, I think it is an ongoing process and it will never end. We are proactive in making sure that we get better and better and better at identifying them. There was an issue with that initial scan, which meant that notification letters were not sent to a group of Scottish taxpayers. And if we had not picked up and corrected that problem, that would have, in due course, fed through to them not getting the right tax as well. But that has been resolved. But there is still ongoing work to refine the database. So, for example, we have identified about 50,000 people on our database who have incomplete addresses, but there is some aspect of the incomplete address data that we hold that indicates that they may be Scottish taxpayers, and we've got an ongoing piece of work to improve the address data there using a third-party data. So we're just constantly proactively refining that. Our initial estimate, I think, was about 2.5 to 2.6 million Scottish taxpayers. The outcome looks like it's about 2.6 million, so that is in line with the original forecast, and that gives me some assurance that we are getting to the bottom of it.
And you know, in percentage terms, could you put a figure on how close to accuracy do you think you are? Are you at 95% or 99%, or where do you think you are?
Well, this is what I mentioned earlier. We don't have a benchmark of who these people are against what which we can measure. When it comes to our original estimate of how many we thought there would be, we are within that, but at the top end of that. If you want to add anything.
I think just to add that when we did the scan last year, we were able to say that we were confident that 98% of the addresses that we had that on our database, for which appeared to be Scottish, could be corroborated from another source. So that doesn't mean that we're 98% accurate, because there could have been missing addresses. But of the ones that we had, we could get sort of separate evidence to justify the fact that 98% of them were in Scotland. We then did some extra work to pick up addresses from other sources where other sources thought there were people living in Scotland who weren't on our books. We went and wrote letters to some of those people. The outcome of that, again, made us believe that our records were probably more up to date than the other sources we were looking at. But it's, as Jim says, this is a constant moving target. And if there was a gold standard of list of people who lived in Scotland, we would use that anyway. So we've got nothing to judge it against.
Okay. And one more question, if I may, Convener. Have you had people challenging their Scottish status, or indeed their non-Scottish status as yet, or is it too early in the process for that to emerge?
I don't think we've got people ringing up and asking questions. Mm-hmm. But and if they can say you've given me a code that says I live in Scotland but I don't, then we will just change that. And I don't think we don't keep a record of that, so long as they've got some evidence to prove that it's different. They'll just tell us I moved yes, 6 months ago, and we'll update our records. But we don't have a challenges as such. I think when we get to self-assessment and the later compliance activity, that may emerge.
I mean, I'm certainly aware of one person who's been in touch with us expressing disappointment that we haven't identified them as a Scottish taxpayer, but when we looked into it, they don't qualify as a Scottish taxpayer, so they may voluntarily make a contribution.
Okay. Thank you.
I wish we could just set your target to find us half a million more. It would give us all, it would help us all in these circumstances. Ash Denham, I think you've got a supplementary, and so is Willie in this area.
Thank you. Good morning. My question covers some of the same ground as Murdo Fraser. So just to talk a little bit more around, you know, the failure to identify some of the Scottish taxpayers, because clearly it's the most important part of it. You've got to know who the Scottish taxpayers are in order to, you know, tax everybody appropriately. So you said that you had an error in your parameters, but basically what that was people had a Scottish address and you failed to count them as Scottish taxpayers. So I suppose my question is, if you're missing, you know, you missed out 420,000 taxpayers, that's not insubstantial, because obviously Scotland is, you know, as part of the UK, is a smaller part. How can Scottish taxpayers have confidence that you will maintain accuracy over this, and also transparency for the Scottish Government in order for them to have confidence that the data is accurate?
First of all, you are absolutely right. So these were people who had addresses on our database that should have enabled us to identify them as Scottish taxpayers, and it was an error in the scan parameters which meant that they were not initially picked up, and that is very regrettable. We have been completely transparent with the Scottish Government and with yourselves about the that problem. I think one thing that I think was quite reassuring is that because of the communications work we had done to raise awareness of that, we were very quickly alerted to the fact that there were people who had not received a letter who you would have expected to receive one. So that communications campaign kind of backed up helping us to get this right. There is some, in the past, people's addresses have not been particularly relevant to their tax liability, and therefore, I guess, in the past, you know, we have applied the kind of data quality standards to that were good enough for what we needed that data for before, and I think this is probably a manifestation of that, because actually their addresses were held in a format which was a non-standard format, and therefore the scan didn't pick it up. I think going forward, we can show that we're already cleansing our address database in response to the fact that Scottish addresses in particular are now much more relevant to tax liability than they were in the past, and therefore, you know, the quality of our database will be better. But it is about, I think, constantly revealing what it is we are doing to improve, and constantly testing are the people you would expect to get an S code, for example, actually getting one. We have done some testing. We have done testing against the Scottish Government's own payroll, and have identified that in 100% of cases where, you know, we hold a Scottish address, there is indeed an S code on their payroll. So that gives us, and we're doing similar validation with a couple of other large employers as well.
So clearly this is an ongoing process, because people obviously will, you know, get to the point where they're starting work. There might be people who leave Scotland to go and live somewhere else and work somewhere else. So it'll need to be an ongoing process. What sort of resources have you committed to maintaining, you know, the database accuracy going forward? And also, if there were to be any issues arising from this, let's say the Scottish Government perhaps identified some people who should be paying Scottish rate of income tax but were not, who would have final oversight over a dispute like that?
On your second point about if there was a disagreement between us, there are rules in the legislation which determine whether you're a Scottish taxpayer or not. They depend on where your main place of residence is for the majority of the year. I think it's unlikely that we would have a sort of generic dispute with the Scottish Government about that, given that it's a fairly objective rule. There might be objections in individual cases, but those would be dealt with through in the normal way. But I don't think that it would be resolved between us and the Scottish Government. Your other question was about resources, what resources we have for keeping the data up to date. Most of that activity will happen through our business as usual activities. So we have ongoing conversations with employers, activity with employers, and checking on employers' payroll activities. We will do more of the comparison scans that we did last year, so comparing our database with external third-party databases of people who live in Scotland to make sure that that's up to date. We will, as Jim said, we will use our personal tax accounts and our digital communications with people to make sure that they get the opportunity to update their addresses. We will take any opportunities we have, not always through paid for advertising, but through other types of communication activity to remind people that it's important to keep their address data up to date. So we recognise this is an ongoing process and it's part of the activity that we will be agreeing with the Scottish Government through the service level agreement.
Thank you. I think.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. It's just to continue this point that Ash Denham raised. An error in the scan parameters sounds like fancy language for a bug in the software to me. Would that be accurate? I mean, how could you initially do a run to 2.5 million or so Scottish addresses that were actually 420,000 people short? How could you not notice that initially, that you were that amount of people short?
These were addresses that had been originally entered onto our database in a non-standard way, so they didn't use the post office's postcode address field. And so when we ran the scan, I think it's not so much a software error as it was an incomplete understanding of how Scottish addresses had originally got onto the database. And so when the scan was run on the assumption that they had all been entered in one format, that picked up all of those, but failed to pick up those that had originally been entered in a different format. And I think that goes back to the fact that historically, you know, we will have had a certain level of concern about the sort of data quality and data standards in relation to address inputting, which we now need to tighten up. So it wasn't so much a bug in the software as just a lack of sufficient understanding of the different formats that could manifest in the database, all of which we needed to pick up. But as I say, there was a backstop, if you like, in terms of identifying the error, because the level of awareness we'd raised meant that people could see that some people who should have received something had not, and that was an alert, if you like. So
it was 400,000, though. I mean, it's hard not to notice a number like that. So I mean, who actually raised the alarm about that missing 420,000? Where did it come from? My point is that should surely have gone through some kind of data validation process at the outset, so that you would be pretty sure that the letters you were issuing were going to the right quantity of people. I mean, 400,000 is a substantial.
Yes, I mean, I think coincidentally, the volume of letters going out, which is 2.4, just over 2.4 million, looked like the level that we expected to go out. So there wasn't an immediate identification of this is not a sufficient number of letters. But it was alerts from people like tax professionals in Scotland who said, I know, because I'm aware from my dealings with you, or employers in Scotland, because I'm aware from my dealings with you, that people should be receiving notification letters. I have seen some people who have and some people who haven't.
I hadn't raised the alarm then, you would still be none the wiser, would you?
Yeah, I mean, there must be a risk that if there are very small numbers, that we wouldn't, you wouldn't be alerted in that way. All we can do, I think, is a sort of on an ongoing basis, keep refining this and just sort of keep proactively on top of it and getting better at it.
I know you had some questions and advice and support as well. Well, can we deal with these questions later? Because Dean wanted to come in on issues of identification issues in that area as well.
Thank you, Convener. We've discussed the position where taxpayers spend some time in the rest of the UK and in Scotland. Can I explore the position where someone spends some time overseas and some time in Scotland? Will the residency test for those individuals be the same as the UK residency test in terms of number of day count, ties to the country and accommodation, or will there be a different test for international taxpayers who spend some time in Scotland?
First of all, you've got to determine whether they're a UK taxpayer. So all the international residence rules will apply in order to decide whether they are liable to tax in the UK at all. Once they have decided that they are a UK taxpayer, then the same rule applies as for other Scottish taxpayers, which is where your main place of residence was for the majority of the year. Obviously, if it's part of a year, then it would be for the part of, depend on that, on where they were for that part of the year. If it's really impossible to determine, it can come down to counting the days. So if there is no obvious main place of residence because they were only temporarily in the country, then we would revert to counting how many days they spent in England or Scotland or Wales. We've tried to keep the number of cases that depend on that, obviously, to the minimum, because it's a burden on people to do that. But there will be cases where that needs to be done.
Okay, so the first test to be applied will be the existing UK test,
yes,
and then that takes you to the within the UK test to determine where you are. Can I ask a slightly separate question? Where will the challenges arise in terms of difficult areas, in terms of taxpayers who have a property? Say, there are a lot of people work in London, they have a property in London, but they also have a property in Edinburgh. Where do you think the difficulties will lie in determining where the main residence is? If there is differential tax between Scotland and the rest of the UK, how will you determine where the main residence is? Again, is it a question of number of days spent in the residence?
No, it's determining which is the main place of residence will depend on a number of things: where their family lives, where they're registered with a doctor, where their kids go to school, that kind of thing. There are a lot of factual things that determine which of, where most people have two residences, it's pretty clear to know which is their main home and which is their weekend place or where they just go for work. Clearly there will be some cases where it's not clear. If it's genuinely not clear, as I say, we can look at counting days, but we do think in the vast majority of cases it will be pretty obvious and easy for people to determine.
Okay, thank you.
Ivan, I think your area around data transfer issues links into identification
issues. Thanks.
So deal with that.
Yeah, sure. The thing I wanted to ask about initially was around about the availability of information from HMRC back to the Scottish Government to enable to calculate what's happening. And I suppose it was round about tracking. Clearly, we'll put a forecast out, but the outturn data for that will be some significant period of time away, a year and a half potentially after the end of the tax year before we know the full final scores on that, which kind of creates difficulty because of the complexity of the Scottish budgeting process going forward. So it was just to be clear, I think reading through the notes you've put in, we'll be in a position where every month effectively for the pay-as-you-earn taxpayers, that information should be made available to the Scottish Government to allow them to track where we are in terms of relative to the forecast. Is that correct? Yeah.
Yes, that's correct. So,
right.
So pay-as-you-earn receipts will represent, I think, about 86-87% probably of all receipts,
yep.
The balance being self-assessment. Self-assessment receipts you will not know till much further down the track. So we think the pay-as-you-earn receipts are the most reliable data that we can give for forecasting purposes. In recent years, we have introduced new rules for the reporting and payment of pay-as-you-earn in year by employers, which have really tightened up on the accuracy of the data that we get from them in year. So employers now have to send us a detailed return and payment for every pay period, which is usually weekly or monthly. And therefore, we've got a much greater confidence today than we would have had, say, 5 years ago in the accuracy of that in-year data. And that is, broadly speaking, the data that the UK government and Office of Budget Responsibility have access to as well in-year. So that's what we would intend to give to the Scottish government. The reconciliation then after the end of the year, we expect would take about 15 months.
Yeah.
And that's because, first of all, we have to operate an end-of-year reconciliation on pay-as-you-earn taxpayers themselves, but also we've got to wait for the self-assessment returns to
come
through.
Okay, but we would have month-by-month a pretty good steer on whether we're falling off a cliff or the thing was holding up.
Yes, and over time, I think you'll be able to build up more confidence in what is the variability in that. But we think that should be relatively stable data.
Moving on just on the data side then, in my understanding at the moment, I think our research people had been in touch with HMRC in the past to try and get information round about Scottish taxpayers broken down by band, so we can understand how many and what the revenue there is, etc., etc. And I think there were some issues around about taxpayer confidentiality, which meant that a lot of this information couldn't be provided. Is that the case? Are you aware of that, or do you see that as a problem, or is there no reason why we shouldn't be able to see that full set of data?
I mean, generally speaking, we won't be able to disclose information that could identify an individual. So in particular, for some of the very high income bands, we may have to sort of aggregate to a level that you can't identify individuals. But apart from that, we should be able to provide that kind of data.
Yeah.
Yes. Provide that. I mean, even at the top end, you should still be able to break it down into groups of a few hundred or something like that. There's no danger there of identifying an individual.
So at the very top end, it's just possible that we will have to aggregate more at a Scottish level than we would at a UK level, mm-hmm. But that's simply to protect people's identities. Otherwise, we can give the breakdown.
But those bands at the moment are quite narrow, I think, in terms of what you break it down to.
And I think probably at that top end, we have had, I mean, that may be the issue that you're referring to, that okay. At the top end, we have had to aggregate some of the bands.
Right, so there's no reason that information shouldn't be available just now. Okay, thanks. Moving on, talking about VAT, which we haven't touched on yet. What is how are you envisaging the process for the assignment of VAT? I know that in our GERS data, there's a mechanism in there, but clearly those are just kind of rough numbers, and where we need to be with VAT for the assignment needs to be a bit more accurate than that.
I'm sorry, listen, Sarah can correct me. That is not something that HMRC will be doing as part of our administration of VAT. It's an exercise that the Treasury will carry out based on VAT receipts and statistics they have about consumption in the economy, but we won't be administering a sort of Scottish rate of VAT in the way that we are with income tax.
No, it is a calculation. There are discussions going on between our analysts and Scottish Government analysts to agree a methodology for apportioning VAT receipts between Scotland and the rest of the UK. It's not straightforward because of the way that VAT works, where there are different stages in the production of things, and you have to attribute it, and there's also zero rated and things. It's not a straightforward process, but there is a joint methodology being developed involving HMRC analysts, Treasury and Scottish Government to get to a stage where we've got a model that everybody's happy with.
But that should be invisible to VAT payers.
Absolutely. Yes.
But clearly it makes a difference in terms of...
It may involve collecting some more evidence. I think there's an idea of having surveys of particular types of expenditure in Scotland where to fill in gaps in the information we've got at the moment. So if we need to do that, then that will happen.
So the mechanism for that is still a work in progress?
Yes.
Okay. And the final point I just wanted to touch on, you talk about your high-level compliance approach, analysis of risks, and likely behaviour of different categories of taxpayers. I don't know if you may want to talk a wee bit more around what exactly your thinking is there.
I think, Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament, I guess, have got two interests in our compliance work. First of all, if and when there is a divergence in rates and thresholds, our management of the compliance risks that gives rise to in terms of identification of Scottish taxpayers and the behaviours that might generate, and then our more general compliance work to close the income tax gap, some of which should benefit Scottish Government. And so the first of those, obviously, that is paid for by Scottish Government, and we'll be agreeing with them what it is that we will do year on year, and how the cost of that and what we do will depend on the compliance risks that the differences throw up. On the general compliance management, I think there are limitations on the extent to which we can disaggregate the effect on Scotland, and also there are timing limitations in the extent to which that data is available when we do the reckoning 15 months after the end of the financial year. The extra contribution, if you like, that the Scottish Government will get from HMRC's general compliance efforts will just come from a share of our UK-wide compliance shield.
Okay, that's fine.
James Kelly had some questions in this area as well.
Sure, it's just around this area of how you build up the forecast that Ivan McKee had asked about. In terms of this figure of 87% of tax receipts, is that 87% of the number of taxpayers, roughly 2.5 million, or 87% of the monetary volume?
It's the revenue. It's 87% of the money.
It's 87% of the revenue. So when you run the first month forecast, you've got if you're collecting it all correctly, you've got 87% in, and the PA, the self-assessment element of it represents 13%. So you know that gives you the ability to run a rough forecast on a month-by-month basis.
Yes.
And obviously you will want to monitor over time that it stays at 86 or 87% because you know, changes in the economy can cause changes in employment patterns and, you know, proportions of self-employed versus employed. So it's not a static picture, but I think based on 2013-14 data, that was the proportions.
And then in terms of, obviously there's a delay in relation to people making self-assessment returns, which can be 10 months beyond the financial year, and there's a further delay before they actually are making those payments. So how do you update your forecast as more information becomes available on the self-assessment?
The intention is that we will publish an initial estimate in our accounts in the summer after the end of the year. So in summer 2017, we will publish an initial estimate of the liabilities for 16-17, which is the amount that the Scottish Government will get. That will be based on PAYE revenues, which we will have had by then, but as Jim said, there still will be self-assessment money and the final end-of-year reconciliation for PAYE to do. A year after that, we should have had all the self-assessment returns in by then, so we should have a much better idea of what's coming in through self-assessment, and we'll have finished the reconciliation through PAYE. So the idea is that we should have had, I think, over 99% of the revenue in by the June, by the 15-month point. And there will be an estimate made of that final small amount, which would still be to be recovered through compliance activity beyond the 15 months.
And how, as you're going through that process, how is that split between self-assessment returns and actual payments made in relation to the self-assessment return?
The calculation is done based on the calculation is done based on the actual receipts through PAYE, the actual receipts that have come in through self-assessment, but which are due by that 31st of January. And then there is an estimate of the amounts that haven't yet been paid that need to be recovered. And that estimate is then added on, but that's a very small proportion.
And how is that then reconciled once the actual payments are coming in for self-assessment?
There's no further reconciliation after the 15-month point. So that is a cut-off, and the adjustment to the block grant adjustment, the adjustment to the block grant is determined at that 15-month point. So anything beyond that, if there is a risk that the amounts that come in are different from what has been estimated at that point, HMRC bears that risk rather than the Scottish Government.
Okay, so there, just to be clear then, there's even when we get to the final figures that are used for the block grant adjustment calculation, there is an element of forecast in relation to self-assessment. Are you able to put a kind of percentage figure on that?
Well, I think it's 1 or 2% of the total. It's a very small amount.
Right. It would be useful if we knew the exact value of the percentage, because although you're saying 1 or 2% is very small, it could be quite sizable in terms of the amount of finance that we're actually dealing with.
Well,
I just mean if we were able to provide, I don't mean provide it right now, but if
okay,
we were able
we
to
can give you some more detail about. I think we do. There is a paper that we've previously issued that gives it some idea of how that's calculated, and I'm very happy to send.
And I appreciate that in absolute terms, you know, even a small percentage of this can be large, but I think that, you know, a key point is that whilst there is a small proportion of that final reconciliation at the 15th month period is still an estimate, that it is not provisional, that is the final reckoning, if you like. So there's no risk that after the 15-month point we'll come along and say that estimate needs to be changed.
Just say for saying sake that the estimate was lower than the actual the actual value. So, you know, therefore, in terms of the amount of money used in the block grant adjustment calculation, if we had the actual figures, that should have been higher. How is there an adjustment made for that? You know, because there's a potential loss there for the Scottish Government.
I think to go back to what Jim said earlier, it's going to be always going to be really difficult to identify amounts recovered, for instance, where an employer goes out of business and hasn't paid us all the PAYE that they owe, and we recover a partial amount when that in the liquidation of the company, we wouldn't necessarily go back and attribute the amount that we got to between individual employees. So there'll be circumstances where it's not possible for us to finally identify the revenues we get in through compliance activity against individual Scottish employees or taxpayers. Similarly, it won't always, where we collect money in respect of an individual through self-assessment, it won't always be able to separate that between the element of income tax on earned income that is due to the Scottish Government and other tax like national insurance or capital gains tax, which is payable. So there'll be all sorts of reasons why, in practice, there will never be, you'll never get an absolute figure. The idea is that we have a cut-off at the 15-month point. We do an estimate where there's a risk, there's an upside risk and a downside risk, and on a very small element of that. And but to do the block grant adjustment, that's the cut-off point.
Right, so there's a cut-off point at that stage. There's an element of it's an estimate, and it's not something that's, you know, revisited in terms of a future reconciliation.
No.
That's correct.
Right.
Thanks very much. Just to follow up on some of Ivan McKee's earlier questions, and can I welcome your response to Ivan on the question about publishing tax revenues broken down by band for Scotland. My understanding is that the Scottish Parliament Information Centre has been unable to access this information so far since an FOI request last year. So if that information is going to be published in future, I think that's very welcome. And it might be useful if you were able to write to the committee afterwards to let us know when that would happen and how frequently. As I understand it, you've also only published illustrative figures for a tax change in relation to a 1p change to the Scottish rate of income tax. And I was just wondering if it was possible to ask what the rationale was for only publishing illustrative figures in relation to that relatively simplistic change. And given that new, more flexible tax income tax powers are coming in future, whether you have an intention to produce a wider range of illustrative figures about the kinds of changes that are now possible.
I think you're right that we've published it. I think we've for a long time published a figure for a penny on income tax for Scotland, and that goes back to the Scottish variable rate, which is even before the 2012 Act. We haven't been asked to publish a wider range of illustrative figures, and I wonder whether that's more for the Scottish Government to do rather than for us, but I think there's no reason why we wouldn't be able to do that if it was required. I think there's always been a statutory requirement, I think, for us to publish that 1p figure.
And it would have to be the Scottish Government that made that request rather than the Scottish Parliament?
I think only because the forecasting of revenues from the Scottish rate is in future going to be for the Scottish Fiscal Commission to do, or for the Scottish Government, and not necessarily for us to do. That's why I would say it would be for them.
Yeah, I think Sarah's right. So, you know, under the MOU and the service level agreement, we will be, you know, clarifying what data we can give to the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the Scottish Government to help them do what they need to do. But, you know, under the devolution of the sort of additional income tax powers, it really now is for the SFC and the Scottish Government to do the forecasting and to assess the impacts of potential policy changes, I think.
I certainly appreciate that. I would merely make the point that, particularly in a period of minority government, it's for the Scottish Parliament to be setting the assumptions under which that work might be carried out, rather than merely the Scottish Government. Okay. Thank you.
Point made.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to pick up a little bit on some of the things you said in response to Ivan McKee about intergovernmental negotiations around the future of VAT assignment, and also one or two of the things you just said in response to Patrick Harvey about the relationship between HMRC's work and obligations with regard to publishing illustrative figures and the work of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So a general question first, then perhaps we can drill down into some of the specifics. I mean, from your perspective, would I be right in understanding that working intergovernmentally is a new venture for HMRC? And if I'm right about that, how would you reflect on it so far, given your experience of it?
We've been working with the Scottish Government since 2012 on the whole devolution, and probably before, I think before that, on the Scottish variable rate, but certainly in terms of the income tax devolution and the devolution of land and buildings transaction tax and landfill tax to Scotland. We've got a pretty good relationship with the Scottish Government, which we've developed over that period. So in terms of working with Scottish Government, it's not new. And it's a strong relationship. I think there's quite a lot of trust on both sides. We've delivered the start off of Revenue Scotland, those taxes. We have got through things like the issue that we had with the 420,000 missing names on the list, where we worked very closely and took the Scottish Government into our confidence at a very early stage and worked with them through a formal process of review points and the governance of the delivery programme. So and we haven't yet got that same relationship with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, because I think they're still establishing themselves. They have now asked to come and talk to us about setting up a memorandum of understanding on all the issues that we need to have on the joint work.
When do you expect that to be something that we could see?
I don't know, because we haven't had that first meeting yet. We had an approach from them a couple of weeks ago. We will have a meeting in the new year. We need to hear from them what they think that agreement should cover. I don't see any problems in us being able to do it, but I can't give an estimate of how long it'll take.
So just trying to understand how HMRC fits into the mosaic of intergovernmental relations and the machinery intergovernmental relations we have. So we know that at the top of that mosaic, if mosaics have tops, sits the Joint Ministerial Committee. But we also know that HMRC is a non-ministerial department. So how does HMRC feed into the JMC and indeed the Joint Exchequer Committee? Are you represented in meetings of the JMC or the Joint Exchequer Committee? And if so, who by?
We're represented at what they call the JECO, so the Joint Exchequer Committee officials,
right,
the official level committee that services the Joint Exchequer Committee. And of course, we report to Treasury Ministers, and so Treasury Ministers will represent our interests in the same way as they do, yeah, as they do the Treasury.
I mean, I think it's worth elaborating a bit on our status as a non-ministerial department, because I think it, in some ways, I think strengthens our ability to work with Scottish Government. So, you know, what that means is that in practice, ministers don't get involved into the day-to-day running of HMRC or the day-to-day administration of the tax system. That is something that we stand apart from ministers on under statute. And so, in that sense, I think we probably already have, a slightly client relationship with Westminster ministers, which I think we can replicate in Scotland. However, we do act under the general direction of Treasury ministers, the Chancellor or a junior Treasury minister that the Chancellor appoints, and in terms of setting our budgets, setting our targets, etc. And that does mean that at ministerial level, we can have representation in cabinet committees or whatever it may be. So being non-ministerial simply means that under statute, it's myself and the other commissioners of Revenue and Customs who are responsible for administering the tax system, and it does, I think, mean we have a slightly, client relationship with whoever it is we're working for, whether it be Scottish Government or Westminster Government.
And final question from me about this. I mean, is most of your experience of intergovernmental relations bilateral between the UK and Scotland, or is some of it quadrilateral? Because, I mean, as I understand it, under the Wales Act, there's now a Welsh rate of income tax, which mirrors the Scottish rate of income tax that we had under our Calman powers. So what's the relationship between the kind of the bilateralism and the quadrilateralism of the way in which it's working?
I mean, there are devolved tax powers for Wales and also for Northern Ireland, and they, like the Scottish devolved powers, vary. Some of them it is about, you know, the devolved government will do their own administration. Some of them it's for HMRC to do the administration for the devolved government. Those are all quite different devolved powers, and therefore they need to be managed individually. So we would have bilateral relations with the government.
Yes, I think the settlements aren't the same. There are differences between in the devolution settlement with Northern Ireland and with Wales and with Scotland. And we have separate relationships with each.
Thank you.
I think Willie Coffey wanted to pick up on some advice and support issues. Willie?
Thanks again. I just wanted to ask you about the advice, support, inquiries, complaints, appeals. It's kind of side of the process. And I think, Ciara, you mentioned there's an estimate of £5 million for that support service, I think you said, but I picked up wrong. You could explain. Is that part of the overall cost estimate for the whole project, and where is that support service provided from? And Jim, I think you mentioned you'll be developing the online side of this whole process, and do you see that cost diminishing as the online system kicks in?
So in terms of support services, so while there is no variation in rates or thresholds, we've estimated that to be quite small, between £1.5 and £2 million a year on an ongoing basis, and that's because, you know, we don't expect Scottish taxpayers to raise many inquiries with us or to challenge their Scottish taxpayer status or non-Scottish taxpayer status, or for us to have to do much to manage compliance risks around identification of Scottish taxpayers. But once there is some variation, then those costs will increase, because we would expect there to be more contact from taxpayers checking their status or querying it or challenging it, and also more compliance risks that we would have to manage, and that's reflected in that £5.5 to £6 million cost instead. What the actual costs will be will depend on what the variation, the differential is, and what the operational risks in terms of contact and the compliance risks turn out to be. So that, you know, that is a bit, you just have to wait and see. You're absolutely right that, you know, under our transformation programme, we are trying to drive down our overall departmental costs of administering the tax system, particularly more routine matters like handling contact, where we believe taxpayers can do more to self-serve, if you like. And you know, I would expect that some of that dividend would be reflected in what it costs to administer Scottish income tax in the future.
But in terms of where that support service will be provided from, where will it be?
There's a range. There will be a range of services. There will be phone calls which come in through our contact centres, which could be routed to anywhere in the country. There's no individual contact centre system. There will be letters, again, which could be dealt with anywhere in the country. There will be complaints, which most of our activity is centralised. So there will not be a dedicated office anywhere to deal with that contact. It will be managed throughout the HMRC system.
And this, that goes back to sort of a point I made earlier about our locations transformation, which is, you know, we are a national business, and increasingly, you know, we don't use local offices to service a local population. There are still obviously some aspects of our work that do require local activity. So whether that be, you know, we have a needs enhanced support service that goes out to vulnerable customers who need face-to-face contact, usually in their home or another site near where they live. We obviously have staff who go out and collect debts, and we also have staff who visit people as part of compliance monitoring. But beyond that, a lot of the work that we do is done nationally and can be done in any location. And therefore, we locate our work where we can get the best workforce and the best estate and the best infrastructure. In the case of Scotland, currently about 12% of our workforce is based in Scotland, which is higher than the, you know, the population proportions in the UK, also higher than the taxpayer population. And, you know, that reflects the fact that people, for example, in East Kilbride are answering phone calls from all over the UK. And under our transformation plans, we wouldn't expect that to change at all.
Okay. Thank you.
Just one other slightly tangential question. I was reading an article in the Financial Times a couple of weeks ago about the increase in the number of incorporations that existed, seemed to have gone up by about 25%, was the claim, certainly. Mm-hmm. In terms of HMRC's database and the information you have available, is there a profile that you could share with the Scottish Parliament, this committee, about what that, if there is that increase, what it looks like? Because obviously the potential there of impact on our income tax stake, mm-hmm, could be significant in the longer term, depending on behaviour changes of individual taxpayers. Have you got any information on that area at all?
I'll certainly look at what we can give you. I mean, you are right that there are incentives in the tax system as well as other reasons why people may choose to incorporate, and that does shift income out of income tax into corporation tax. And depending on what policy decisions were taken in Scotland, that could have an impact in Scotland, which might be different from the rest of the UK. And there is no doubt that there's been a trend of increasing incorporation of businesses. People do it for a variety of reasons, but tax is definitely an incentive to incorporation. We look at what we can provide you.
Thank you. I don't think anybody has indicated any other questions. So can I thank both Jim Hara and Sarah Walker for coming and giving us evidence today. Certainly explained clearly the challenges you faced in a very transparent way. So we're very grateful for you coming along today. I now close this particular part of the meeting and we move into private.